Hello, good morning everyone. Today we are going to see operating system, unit 2, session 4. In the previous topic, we have studied the concept schedulers. So what is the work of the scheduler? To move the processes from one state to another state. And based on the various situation, the various schedulers work to move the processes from one state to another state. In today's session, we are going to study various possibilities of the processes. Under which conditions the processes moves from one state to another state. First, we'll understand the various possibilities of process states. So, as we all know that whenever the processes has to be created, those have to be brought from secondary memory to main memory. That is from new state to ready state, and that will be done by the long-term scheduler. And we already know that in the ready state, the processes will be waiting for the chance for execution by the CPU, and now the process will be selected from the ready queue, that is from ready state, by the short-term scheduler. Short-term scheduler will select the processes based on the scheduling algorithm. And now suppose the process P1 is selected and will be sent to the running state for execution by the CPU, and once the P1 process finishes its execution, it will be sent to the terminate state by the short-term scheduler. So this was the one possibility. Next possibility we'll see. Now suppose another process has come, that is P2, from new state to ready state. Now P2 has come to the ready state, but there is not enough space to hold the process P2 because already the main memory is full. Then such processes will be sent to the ready suspended state for waiting in the secondary memory. As we all know that ready suspended is a secondary memory where the processes will be waiting. And another situation is when the process, now suppose this process P2 wants to use the any input output resource, and the resource is already busy, it is not available, then even such processes will be sent to the ready suspended state. In these situations, when the main memory is full and when the processes immediately, if they want to use the resources, those processes will be sent to the ready suspended state for waiting in the secondary memory. And whenever there is a free space in the main memory, or when that resource becomes available, then that process will be brought back to the main memory for execution, and then it will be sent to the running state. And in running state, if the process finishes its execution, then those will go to the terminate state. And if the resources and if the processes wants to use the resources, those will be sent to the waiting state here. Now P2 has come here. Now whenever the P2 is moved to the waiting state, now the CPU becomes here free now. Now P2 has moved to the waiting state. Now CPU is here free. No? So for time being, the another process will be selected by the short-term scheduler. Now the short-term scheduler selects next process, that is P3, and will be sent to the running state. Now in a running state, P3 is executing and P2 is executing here resources. Now when the P2 finishes its execution, it will be sent to the ready state after finishing the execution, after finishing the use of resources. Now already the process P3 is running here. When the P3 finishes its execution, it will terminate, and then the P2 will be given the chance for execution. Another possibility is, now suppose the process P4 has come from new state to ready state. Now P4 wants to Now the P4 has moved to running state, and P4 wants to use the CPU. Now the P4 is assigned only 2 minutes to use the CPU. Okay, there are such algorithms where the processes will be assigned some specific time, or based on the, or another situation is if the higher priority process comes, then the CPU will be taken away from that lower priority process and will be given to the higher priority process. Okay, in such cases, the CPU will be taken away from the processes and will be given to such processes, those who have higher priority, or if the, its time expires. Now suppose the P4 has given only 2 minutes to use the CPU, and after 2 minutes the CPU will be taken away from process P4, and then the process P4 will be moved to the ready state now, and another process will be given the chance for execution. Let us take another possibility. Now the process P5 has come from new state to ready state. Now the process P5 is given the chance for execution. So now the process P5 is executing, and in between the process P5 wants to use the input output resources. So P5 will be moved here. And if the resources are available, immediately the resources will be assigned to P5. It will execute it, and it will move away to the ready state after execution. And what if the resources are not free, resources are not available, then in such cases, instead of waiting in the main memory, the process P5 will be moved up to block suspended state. Those will be time being suspended. That means the process P5 is waiting in now secondary memory, and that will be done by the MTS, medium term scheduler. And whenever the resources are available, again that process will be moved back to the main memory, and it will execute, and it will go to the ready queue, and then back to the running state, and then it finishes. So these are the various possibilities we have seen here, and even the MTS will act here to bring the processes from main memory to secondary memory. Now we'll see process scheduling. Process scheduling has two types, non-preemptive scheduling and preemptive scheduling. So process scheduling is determining which process moves from ready state to the running state. See, it is very important to select the processes from ready state. Okay, as the processes comes from new state to ready state, and in the ready state those will be waiting. To select the processes from ready state is very important, and that is done by the short-term scheduler based on the scheduling algorithms. So these scheduling algorithms are divided into two types, that is non-preemptive scheduling algorithms and preemptive scheduling algorithms. So this part is very important here. So these scheduling techniques will be applied there to select the processes from ready state to running state. Now let us see what are these non-preemptive scheduling and preemptive scheduling, because the algorithms are classified in these two types. Non-preemptive scheduling. A scheduling discipline is non-preemptive if once a process has been given to the CPU, the CPU cannot be taken away from that process. As we have seen that from the ready state, the process will be selected and will be given to the CPU for execution. So once the CPU is assigned to the process, the CPU will be not taken away from these processes until it finishes its full execution. In non-preemptive scheduling, a scheduler executes another job in the following two situations. When a process switches from running state to waiting state, or when a process terminates. So this means in a non-preemptive scheduling, the CPU will be given to any other process in two situations. One is when the process moves from
running state to waiting state. So in this case, the CPU will be free. Then the CPU will be given to any other process. Another situation is when the process finishes its execution. So even in this case, the process will be given to process CPU will be given to another process. So in these two situations, in a non-preemptive scheduling, the process will be given to the CPU. Now next we'll see preemptive scheduling. The scheduling in which once a process has been given to the CPU can be taken away from that process. So running process can be interrupted if a high priority process enters the queue and is allocated to the CPU. Okay, this means that once the CPU is given to any process, the CPU can be taken away from that process at any time, because if the high priority process comes, then the chance will be given to the high priority for execution. So the CPU will be taken away from such processes and will be given to the high priority process. So in between, there is an interruption which keeps on occurring here, and it is also sometimes see some of the processes will be assigned the times. So based on the given time, the process has to execute. For example, every process has to execute only for 2 minutes. Then when the time expires, the CPU will be taken away from that process and will be given to the next process. Let us see the difference, non-preemptive scheduling and preemptive scheduling. See, once processor starts to execute a process, it must finish it before executing the other. It cannot be paused in middle. See, once the CPU has given to any process, it must finish its full execution, and in between there is no interruption, no disturbance. The process has to finish its execution. The processor can be preempted to execute a different process in the middle of the execution of any current processes. Okay, the process execution will be stopped in between at any time and will be given to other process. The process cannot be interrupted till it terminates or switches to waiting state. And here, process can be terminated in between. Next is, if a process with long burst time is running CPU, then another process with less CPU burst time may stall. So this means, now suppose a particular process is taking too much long time for execution, that we call it as burst time. Okay. Now, then other process which takes only the less time for execution. So because of one process, the other less process time has to keep on waiting for the chance. That is the problem in this. If a high priority process frequently arrives in the ready queue, the low priority process may stall. So in this, the problem is that if the high priority process keeps on coming, then the low priority process will never get a chance to execute. They have to keep on waiting for their chance. So this is the problem in this scheduling. The CPU utilization is less compared to preemptive scheduling. So in this non-preemptive, CPU sometimes remains idle in this case, whereas in this, CPU utilization is more compared to non-preemptive scheduling. So these are the difference between non-preemptive scheduling and preemptive scheduling. Based on this, scheduling algorithms are divided, in which you are going to study in further topics. Thank you.